Welcome to episode 119. Today's guest is Siobhan Fallon Hogan. She has been in Forrest Gump, Saturday Night Live, Seinfeld, Men in Black, Holes. She is immensely talented, and I might be understating that. She is so cool. She is so funny. I absolutely think the world of her before the interview. I can tell you now, after the interview, she was even better than I thought she'd be, and I thought she was going to be phenomenal. So what a blessing having her on the show was. I have to say it's been a bittersweet week for sure. I recorded this interview almost 2 weeks ago, and I usually don't sit on interviews. I mean, I have a couple in storage that I'm going to plan on releasing, and I've held on to them for a couple reasons. There's like three or four I have like that, but this wasn't supposed to be one of those. This was supposed to come out right away. A few days after I recorded this interview, my father passed. And I usually don't bring up my personal life on the podcast. Oh, I do. I shouldn't say that. I do bring up my podcast. And I don't know how deep personally I go or how deep I don't go. But I have to say, you know, it's bittersweet. And I mentioned bittersweet. Obviously, the sweet part was Siobhan and how awesome she is and was. And the bitter part is, you know, the loss of my father. In full disclosure and full honesty, what I pride myself on, it's definitely been a tough road. I love this podcast, and I've said this on numerous occasions. My podcast has been, I think a lot of people appreciate my guests. I think a lot of people appreciate my honesty, and it's certainly been a form of therapy to me to kind of just air things out. But yeah, I mean, it's been a tough few weeks. I certainly don't want people. I received a few emails asking if the podcast was done or if I'm on hiatus, and that's not the case at all. It's just I've been attending to a lot of things. I've been with family. I've been doing my thing, and it's been a very tough couple weeks. You know, there's always a notion when somebody close passes to you, like, why me? You know, why did it happen to me? You know, I mean, who else is it supposed to happen to? Like, who else is death supposed to happen to? Is it always supposed to be somebody else? Is the arrow never supposed to fall on you? I mean, I don't know. Death, I will never understand it. I will never understand how it works. I mean, I'm not the most religious person in the world. I wish I was as religious as I was when I was younger, but I'm clearly not. But that doesn't mean I don't believe either. I'm somewhere in the middle. And I know there's words that describe people, agnostic or whatever. I don't know where I am on that scale. But without even going to the religious point or what, you know, the why me. My dad was such a beautiful guy. He was one of the best people I've ever known. Like, he was my movie buddy. He was the guy I watched television with. He's the guy that I talked to, I spent time with, we went on trips together. He's absolutely my best friend, and he's certainly missed dearly, you know. A couple of days ago, I was writing his obituary, and if you told me, you know, 2 weeks ago I'd be writing my dad's obituary this week, I would have said you were full of shit. But, you know, there's a saying, if you want to make God laugh, tell him you have plans. Tell him your plans, and I'm certainly not, I mean, a little bit over the top, but no, I have some great guests scheduled, and I have some wonderful people in my personal life that I absolutely adore, and that have been so kind to me, and every step of the way have been supportive, and you know, without mentioning names, I'm just so thankful for those people, whether it's the people I work for or the, you know, friends that I have. But I always have to say, too, you know, if you weren't a kind person to my dad and you want to offer up condolences, truthfully, shove them up your ass. You know, whether it's his relatives or people we knew. And I know a lot of people are about forgiveness in times like this. Not me. I want you to be the person you were when my father was alive. If you were an asshole to my dad and you want to offer up condolences, take those condolences, wrap them up very nicely. And to steal from The Rock, shove them up your ass. I want nothing to do with phony people, ever. I mean, there's just too many fakes and phonies in the world as it is. Never mind the podcasting world that's filled with phonies. But believe me when I tell you, I am going to address those phonies by name in upcoming episodes. Bank on it. Bet on it. I 100% will. You know, but I have to say the one thing that has me that's gotten me through this, outside of the great support and having a wonderful family that I do, and just thinking about things like, you know, you think about the great people in our world, right? The great people that have passed, Martin Luther King and JFK and Abraham Lincoln, just people that are, you know, Harriet Tubman. I'm just people over the course of history that accomplished so much. Like, death just doesn't discriminate. It's just, you know, and when people talk about living your best life and YOLO, you know, I mean, they're crazy and they're kind of foolish terms, but at the heart of them is kind of true, right? You get one time around. And I know it's probably not popular or kosher to bring up a Kevin Spacey movie, but there's such an awesome line at the end of K-Pax, right? Jeff Bridges is in it. Wonderful movie. When he talks about repairing the rapport Jeff Bridges has with his son, who's played by he was in Breaking Bad, Aaron Paul, and Pratt, who is played by Kevin Spacey, turns to Jeff Bridges' character talking about his son. He goes, "My advice to you is to get it right this time, because this time is all we have." And I know it's so basic and so, like, obvious, but I have to say it's so truthful at its core, and it's so powerful at its core. Like, if you aren't appreciating the people in your life now, then you deserve every bit of grief you get when they pass. Like, if you aren't hugging your mom or your dad or your daughter or your son or whoever, or a friend or whomever, and just embracing the people that are good to you in life and that are kind and beautiful, then you deserve all the grief and heartache that death brings. Like, you deserve it. You should appreciate the now, and believe me, that's one of the biggest lessons I've taken out of this. You know, and it was so corny when I was younger, or when people tell you, you know, appreciate what you have, and, you know, hug somebody, tell somebody I love you. It is so goddamn true. It is so freaking true. Like, to appreciate those that are good to you and kind to you. And I'm not saying to appreciate all people, because all people aren't good people. But I'm saying the people that you love in your life, don't let a second go by without telling them what they are and what they mean to you. And I always made it a point to tell my dad, you know, how much I loved him. And it was so corny, because sometimes it would come out of nowhere. You know, we'd be watching a movie, I don't know, Django Unchained, Quentin Tarantino's movie. And he'd be like, "Wow, Christoph Waltz is really good in this movie." I'd be like, "Dad, you know, I love you, right?" Like, they'd come out of nowhere. I would say it out of nowhere. So in that way, it doesn't ease things, but I think my dad passed knowing how much he was loved, not just by me, but by my family. And I'm so sorry to ruin this awesome interview with my sobbing in the beginning of it, but it really is a fantastic interview. So I apologize in that regard. Siobhan, I'm sorry if I ruined this interview. You were phenomenal in it, and it actually cheered me up listening to your part of it. This part, not so much. But that's all I've got. I'll be back stronger than ever. Life is full of ups and downs. So without any more of my feeling sorry for myself, I bring to you the great Siobhan Fallon Hogan.
Hey, Forrest. Don't. I want to tell you I love you.
I love you too, Daddy.
I'll be right here when you get back.
You understand this is the bus to the school now, don't you?
Of course. The new address is yours. 9 Forrest Gump.
Motion pictures, can't get enough. Cinephile, movie lover, and a big movie buff. Talking to actors, directors, innovators, athletes to writers, real trailblazers. Yeah, originator, not a duplicator. So honest, always authentic. Tune in, trust me, you don't want to miss it. This is the Monday Morning Critic. Amazing life journeys, great interviews from sports analysts, even reporters too. Captivating, always top content, bringing top quality, everybody's talking. Yeah, originator, not a duplicator. So passionate and so authentic. Tune in, trust me, you don't want to miss it. This is the Monday Morning Critic. Woo! Hey, yo, you ready? Let's do it.
My next guest's work on the small screen and the big screen is truly amongst my favorite. Her work on SNL is epic. I absolutely love everything about her filmography, who she is. She's really one of the best actors on the planet. Her name is Siobhan Fallon Hogan. Siobhan, how are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. So, like, I'm going through your life, and I feel like I know your life as good as you at this point. And, you know, I was really refreshed, and I didn't know this about you. Like, not that it should be made a point of it, but, like, your faith really kind of drives who you are. Is that a fair point, or am I kind of reaching it with that?
I guess that would be the case. sometimes you feel really pious saying that, but also, you know, it could be my Irish Catholic guilt driving me, too. So it's one or the other.
But I feel like faith-based, like, I don't know, like, if actors have hidden their religion, because I feel like there's been a new, I don't know what word you would use, a new birth or rebirth of faith-based movies. So it's like, I don't know if it's, like, people clearly love these types of movies. Like, is it because people are, like, religion is just such a complicated matter, and I don't get it.
You know, I don't really get it either, but I do love, like, what was the one that was just there? Heaven is for Real, and those movies are so good.
Right.
Of course, I haven't been in any of the faith-based, but I would love to be in them. But, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's kind of a topic that was kind of ignored for a little while. I don't know why in the films. And now, it comes down to money. When I think when those did well, then they start doing more of them.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, I grew up Catholic, confirmation, I did all that. And you know, right. I always have a mixed bag when it comes to religion, because there are truly most people that practice religion, regardless of what it is, are just great people. But, like,
right.
My neighbor is, like, one of those Catholic people that, like, lives life awfully, like Monday through Saturday, they are just not good people. Like, they cheer for the downfall of others. Yeah. But like, for that 1 hour on Sunday, Siobhan, they turn into the nicest people on the planet.
Well, that's just about every religion. Don't you?
Absolutely.
I mean, good, bad, and everything.
Yes, yeah. Yes. It's definitely not just the cat. It's every religion. Absolutely.
Yes.
So I have to say, you know, do you teach a lot of acting? I know you've done a lot of speaking. I know you're very, you do a lot of that. Do you find yourself, do you teach acting as well?
Do you know what? When I'm not working, I will teach. I've taught, I used to do a seminar at the Atlantic Theater Company through NYU on how to write your own one-person show. And I've done that at a couple different colleges. And then I've done a kids class in my town. You know, I'll do it just when I have time. I'll be like, okay, I think I have a 5-week period. I'm going to do it. And then every summer I try to do like a little camp because I love kids. So I do like a camp. It's like 4 days, 3 hours a day, which is hilarious because, you know, it's kind of like everything that I would have loved to have done when I was a little kid. Like I do like puppets. I do makeup. And then of course, snack time is my favorite where I'm like, have the kids come at 9 a.m. at like 10. They have like chocolate chip cookies and, you know, popsicles and all this gross stuff. And they're like, and then I send them home to their parents at like noon and they're like wired.
But I got to say, if I took up acting, right? So like, I'd want to get your perspective. I had a guest earlier in the year who was just he's very much like you, very kind person, Austin Pendleton, right? Like a good.
Oh, I love him.
Yeah, like a good person. Like that's I guess you could teach anything, right? It all, and it's all dependent on the teacher and how they like kind of, you know, just, I don't know. How?
Well, yeah, well, here's the thing. Like, you know, I say to, like, I actually had a kid come over tonight that's like, you know, when a lot of times when people get them kid, their kids into being child actors, you're like, oh, God, don't do that. But this kid's really talented. His mother's like, hey, this kid, he has an audition for this sketch comedy show. Would you mind, you know, coaching him? So anyway, the long and the short of it is, you know, he said to me, well, you know, I go to this person who tapes me and they're so mean. And I said, you know, that's the problem. Like, a lot of times with kids, a lot of times teaching them is the people that really just want to be an actor. So they're kind of like bitter. So that's one thing that I always say to kids. I'm like, listen, when everyone tells you you're no good between this age and this age, that's impossible. Mm. You know what I mean? You know, you don't know, you're flowering. So just, you know, you got to look for the good in kids. But it's rough when you run into a bad teacher, because a lot of acting teachers, unfortunately, want to act, and they're not doing it, so that's why they're teaching.
Oh, that is so well said.
It's kind of like me, 10 weeks out of the year.
Yeah,
so when I send out an email, I'm like, okay, listen, I'm going to be teaching a course. They're like, oh, she's unemployed again. Or it's that week in the summer.
I never make an interview about me, but to add to your point, like, I remember when I was younger, and I really wanted to play the piano, and I had this teacher, Bruce, who was just awful to me. Like he yelled to make his points. But now that what you just said, like, he was probably not in a place in his life that he wanted to be in. Like, I'm sure he didn't want to be teaching a 9-year-old the piano, so he took it out on me. And I totally get that point. Like, that hits home big
time. Which is really funny when you can really have good perspective on it. Like, if you do want to write later, it's so funny. Like, my daughter, I have three kids. My youngest daughter took piano, and I remember she told me that the teacher put his head, he didn't know she was looking, and he put his head in his hands and just shook it like, oh. Because seriously, what could be worse than teaching piano? Because there are a lot of really untalented piano players, and just hearing that banging over and over again. Like, I know I took piano when I was little, and I have to say I was pretty good. My sister Sheila, though, I'd always make her go first, and then I would fall asleep on the couch. My teacher's name was Mrs. Doyle. And then she literally would play the same song every week for weeks and never have practiced it in between. And I thought, Mrs. Doyle must be like, could this girl just maybe, I don't know, I'm just thinking, maybe could she practice once?
I gotta believe that your house seems like such a fun place to be with your kids, and you have
great
family atmosphere.
Well, now we're at a weird stage, because get this one. My oldest daughter, she just turned 24. She just got a job with the New York Post as a political writer.
Wow.
Now, she's moved out of the house. My son is a junior at West Virginia, and my oldest daughter is a senior in high school. So tomorrow, I'm such a bad mother. You know, most people know where their kids are going at this point for college. Tomorrow morning at 4 in the morning, we're flying to University of South Carolina and then driving to North Carolina. But anyway, it's like I'm looking around myself. You know, thank God we're on the radio, because my house is so messy right now. It's like a scene.
I mean, do your kids, and I have this down the line, but I'll ask you now. Do your kids, I always wonder how kids react to, you know, obviously your husband's very successful in a different line of work. But, you know, what are your kids' reactions to, like, your filmography, the fact that mom is a very successful?
It's weird. I remember my oldest daughter when I was little, and something came on TV, and she screamed. We were living in New York City at the time in an apartment, and she screamed, oh, what are you doing on TV? And she ran in the other room. And then another time, just because you asked me this off the top of my head, I have a house in upstate New York, and we'd go to Cooperstown once a summer because my husband loves baseball. And someone said, oh, you know, are you Siobhan Fallon, you and Men in Black, blah, blah, blah. And my daughter, without, you know, the one who's the political reporter now, is very serious and said, ugh, she's all over town. But I think they get used to, like, you know, like, my son was a junior and he got to come to the 40th SNL party. So it's like a lot of stuff that becomes, I mean, of course, that was insanely exciting to him.
Oh, my God.
But they got to do a lot of really cool stuff, but they also don't, like, idolize celebrities because of it, because they've been on a lot of movie sets and they get it. You know what I mean? I think they get it.
And one of the things of the many things I really like about you is that you have a great sense of humor, and I don't care what line of work you're in. I just feel like that is one of the things where people almost want you to know how funny they are versus just be yourself. Like, this is who you are. I work with people that, like, legitimately say, like, I'm a funny person. Like, I don't know. Like, it drives me nuts. I feel like
that's horrible. And that's one thing when you see, like, I always tell kids too, like, there's nothing worse than seeing someone on stage that thinks that they're funny, because you're like, ew, I don't want to laugh because you think you're funny. But what was I going to say about that? I forgot.
It's forced. It's like, I don't know. It's just, it's not natural. It's, I don't know.
Yes. Yeah.
You know? So I'm looking at your college. You went to Lemoore. You went to Catholic U to get your MFA.
Right.
Do you feel like that? I mean, looking back on your enormous accomplishments, do you feel like that was necessary? Do you feel like that's really helped you along the way? Or was it like a mentor, Siobhan, or was it a mixture of both?
You mean going to graduate school and that kind of thing?
Right, getting the MFA, I
I was from a small little town, and, you know, a lot of times people say, you can't go into acting. I'll never forget this person said to me, you can't go into that. People have been studying acting since they were 5 years old that live near New York City. I think a lot of it, what it does is builds confidence, and you then get experience on stage. So, you know, you can do college theater, and then you're like, oh, geez, well, I was good for college, but am I good enough for graduate school? And you go to graduate school, and you're like, oh, I guess I can compete. And then you go to New York. And, you know, and you stand online, you're a big loser. And then you're like, oh, I did a little play. You know, it's basically about building confidence for a while. You know what I mean?
Right.
Saying, I guess I can do this. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's what it was for me. And you get training. Like, actually, after graduate school, I studied the Meisner technique, you know, in New York. And I always tell kids, you know, study the Meisner technique and you can save a whole lot of money.
Right. Right. Is there a mentor that stood out for you too? Or is it just kind of like the experience?
Let me think. Well, you know, there was a priest at Catholic U named Father Hartke. He was a fabulous guy, and he looked like Marlon Brando, and he had white hair. His family actually owned Walgreens, like pharmacies.
Wow.
And my first year in New York, I was like, oh my gosh, this is so bad. I mean, I've got making about 2 cents an hour as a receptionist because I wasn't a good enough waitress. I had to be a receptionist. And I was like, this is going nowhere. I'm a big loser. And I remember he called me that Christmas. I was living like in a 2x4 with another girl. And our apartment was so small that my clothes hung over my bed and my feet touched her feet. And then somebody broke through the window, and I was like, oh my God, I'm going to get killed. I got to get out of here. But anyway, he called me and said, he used to call me Irish. He's like, Irish, Father Gilbert Hartke. I said, hi, Father, how are you? He said, for this Christmas, I give you the gift of courage. And it was like really like something to me. I was like, oh my gosh, okay, I got to stick this out. And then another time someone said, who came to Catholic U when I was in graduate school, and he was like 38 years old, which at the time I thought was like ancient when I was, you know, I was like probably 23 or something. And I was like, and he said, just remember when you're in the arts, never compare yourself to other people your age, because people in business can, you know, especially at the time, I mean, this was like the 80s. So people were like, oh, I got out of college and I'm making like 60 a year. And I was like, oh my gosh, I got a $250 bonus answering the phones. Anyway. So he was like, life is not a track meet. Don't compare yourself. And I always remembered that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I think that you can't do that when you're in the arts. It's a different, it's like slow and steady wins the race, you know?
Right, right.
Unless you're related to someone in the business.
that's true. And, you know, one of the things is when you speak to like, so college level kids or people that are you know, want to be actors, is there a question you get a lot that there's really no answer to?
Let's see. You know, I can't think of one off the top of my head, but you do get a lot of like things have changed. Like you'll get a lot of kids now that really just want to be famous. You know, they're not really that interested in the art.
Yes.
Or, you know, so that's a huge change that I've noticed when I do these like college, you know, one woman show seminars.
That was my follow up question to you, because it seems like if that's their intention to get famous, that's a very lonely road.
I think so, because are you really in it? You know, I mean, like, I would kill to do a play, but, you know, sometimes you can't afford to do a play. So, yeah, it's kind of, do you really love this or not?
Right, right. No, that is so well said. And, you know, your first break, and I hope I'm right here, otherwise I'd be pretty embarrassed. Is it the Golden Girls? Would you say that was it? That was,
yes. Isn't that funny?
That is awesome.
As a matter of fact, I did the Golden Girls, and I was so thrilled. And, you know, it's like a week long when you're a guest star. And at the end of the week, I wrote them each a thank you note as if I was like part of the cast, like it was like a show. And I remember they were like, what's this? As a matter of fact, the producer, this is so ridiculous. I was so pathetic. He came and he was like, oh, and he thought he was looking at me and he was his arms wide open. And he passed me and hugged the girl behind me. And I was like, oh my gosh, I thought he was going to hug me.
How great is that? Like,
and it's so funny.
Are you like blown? Like, is that like mind blowing? Like, I mean, obviously you're somebody who is, you know, you're talented at that point. You have, you know what you're doing, but like, that's a huge, I mean, at the time, it's a huge break, right? I mean, that's pretty big.
Yeah. You know, and, you know, let me tell you something. As they say, it's all who you know. A lot of it is through, you know, that was a guy that I became friends with in LA and he was a writer. He's like, look, I can't get you on the show, but I can get you an audition. And so they're still a really good friend of mine. His name's David Goodman, and he's now the president of the Writers Guild. And I'm a matter of fact, he spoke at something, and I saw a video of it. I was like, David, you became somebody. We did it.
and that is like I mean, they must have been so. That's really a sweet gesture for somebody that's like, you know, I guess you would say green or but to do that, that's a very kind thing to write letters.
And then it's kind of like, be careful what you wish for, because I remember, you know, a lot of times we're on a television show, especially a comedy, the old sitcoms, you know, there was so many more in those days, but the actors become such big stars that the director really can't direct them anymore. And a lot of times the directors are just coming in to do one or two episodes. So they can't, because the actors have become so big that they're like, don't you dare criticize me. So the guest star is completely the target. So you'll be getting so many notes that your head is spinning. And of course, I was never like small. I was kind of like, go big or go home. And I think my friend David was like, oh my God. You know, because they'd be like, now Siobhan, you know, you tone it down a little. You know, so I've always gotten that, you know.
Yeah.
You can always, we can always, I'm glad you're where you are, but we can always bring it back a little.
You know, and I always get like, I hate like complimenting people and when I really mean it, because I always feel like I'm patronizing my guests. But like, I have to say, the 1991-92 cast of Saturday Night Live, especially you, in my opinion, is the best cast ever in the show's history. Like, and I can back that up, but that,
well, here's the thing. I wouldn't be able to tell you because I can't stay up that late. So I haven't seen it in years. So the cast could be spectacular and I could bump into them on the street and be like, I have no idea who you are. But no, first of all, personality wise, I mean, Chris Farley was a great friend of mine. I loved Chris. I mean, he's a person, hilarious, great guy. Talk about a faithful guy. I mean, unbelievable person. You know, Chris Rock was great. Adam Sandler. We had a really great group. And so that Julia Sweeney was great. And I mean, we really, really had, and Victoria Jackson. I loved my group and Ellen Cleghorn. But,
Phil Hartman was part of that group.
Phil Hartman, yeah, it's crazy.
Dana Carvey, Mike Myers. I mean, that's unbelievable.
I mean, I love Dana. He was so insanely talented. I mean, still, he's just unbelievably talented.
Is working for Lorne Michaels, is that high pressure? Like, I feel like he's a guy you don't want to mess up too many times in front of. Like, I mean, I could be wrong.
The whole thing is so high pressure that sometimes I think I have, like, the first couple of years after I off that show, I used to walk slowly past 30 Rock, like, a block away. Because it's, you know, let's face it, you know, it's just, I mean, it's pressure. I mean, because you're supposed to be funny. You got to get stuff on. Then you go on Saturday, you know, you do the dress rehearsal, and they cut half the show, half an hour before the show, and you're like, uh-oh. So it's big pressure, you know? And plus, I was never a stand-up comic. So it's not like, you know, stand-ups, I think, really understand and can deal with that kind of pressure. Whereas if you're an actor, you have, like, you know, if you're in a play, you have weeks to prepare. Or if you're in a television show, you have, like, time to prepare. This is just like, here's your script. Good luck. You got 2 days. Okay, got cut. Now we're changing lines. You got 10 minutes to learn the new lines before you're on air.
Yeah.
So it's pretty rough.
You know, Siobhan, I never thought of that. Like, you didn't do stand-up, and a lot of your castmates here, I want to say almost like 75 to 80% were stand-up comedians.
Completely. As a matter of fact, I oh my gosh. And, you know, and a part of being a stand-up is when the guest star comes in and you pitch, everybody had to pitch their ideas for what sketch they want to get on. They're like really good at pitching stories. Where that's why Chris Farley was so funny, because he was not a stand-up. And he'd say, you know, like people would, you know, they come to like a cast room and they say, well, you know, I just read, I don't know, War and Peace, and there's this one thing, and then get to Chris and he'd go, well, I'm not much of a reader per se. But I thought it'd be kind of funny if we did a sketch on a ski lift. You know, and then his guest hosts could be pretty, some of them could be rough. Be like, yeah, what are you going to do on the ski lift? I don't know. Anyway, it was insane.
You know, and I never, you know, obviously I never knew Chris Farley. I never knew Robin Williams. But I feel like when they both passed, like, I feel like I lost, in the cheesiest way possible, like, I feel like I lost somebody that I did know. You know what I'm saying? Like,
huge, huge. Yeah. And because what's so rough, especially like Robin Williams, who I didn't even know, but you're like, oh my gosh, it's so sad to think someone that funny was so sad, you know?
Right.
You hate to see someone suffer, and oh, I don't know, it's just, yeah, I totally get what you're saying.
Yeah, and you know, and I have to say that, you know, I mean, Jimmy, who shares your name, and I know you guys aren't related, and you probably get that a lot, but, you know,
yes.
He used to, you know, Jimmy's thing is he can't hold it in through a scene, and you know, but I used to hear like Lauren, like he didn't think that was funny. Like he thought, like, you know, he wasn't okay with that for a while. So I don't know. A lot of pressure.
I don't really know. I wasn't on when Jimmy was on. I love Jimmy. I think he's hysterical. Matter of fact, I did a movie. I did Fever Pitch when he was the lead, and the driver picked me up at the airport and he said, that was really nice of your brother to get you a part in the movie. I was like, yeah, you know, I was on SNL before him. And yeah, it was nice of him. Anyway, so I'm right over here. Thanks.
Yeah, and it's, you know, I don't know, it just seems like the group you are with is just amazing. And I mean, and I know, just kind of bouncing back and forth here, do you get a lot, I read where you get a lot of your sense of humor from your dad. Is that?
My father was insanely funny. And I mean, like, not just, I mean, of course, everybody wanted to be around him because he was so funny, like at any party, he was great at giving speeches. He was completely irreverent. You know, if he, like, I remember one time he got the Catholic Charities Award and he was like, oh my God, I got an award from you guys. I've never got an award in my life. I was one of 11. You must want to check. You know, he was just mocked everything. Nothing was sacred with my father. He was really funny. They used to say, I remember the college he went to, Le Moyne College up in Syracuse. I actually went there too, a small little Jesuit. There was a cartoon of him that said, Bill Fallon needs to take it on the road. I have my son who's a junior at West Virginia, Peter. He's hilarious too. And he's so much, it's like my father reincarnated. Mm. It's like, you know, it's just that funny that you can't teach.
Yeah, I mean, do you miss, and I'm bouncing all over the place here, you know, I do want to say, your parents wanted you to be a teacher. I think you would have made a great teacher.
I know, but I'm not very smart.
No, that has nothing to do with it.
I get really tired. Teachers have to have such stamina. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, if you're a teacher, you have to be like, it's like having a birthday party every single day. After one of my kids had a birthday party, I need to sleep for like a week. I have a really, really weak constitution.
Do you consider your time in SNL a huge part of your life, especially your career?
Well, I'll tell you what. After I got off SNL, literally for years, you'd walk into an audition there and people go, oh, Siobhan, this is Siobhan Fallon. Now, Siobhan, are you free right now with your schedule? I'm like, I haven't been on that show in 5 years, but people don't know, so that's fine. I'll just ride it. But I mean, it was definitely, I'm so grateful as far as it opened it so many doors, you know, especially with film, you know, because they're like, okay, yeah, we'll let you audition if you're on SNL.
Yeah. And you know, obviously you're on, for those that they all know, but Seinfeld as Tina, that had to be a great experience too. I was watching, just to refresh my memory, I know all these skits, but I watched one where Jerry Seinfeld on SNL was teaching a class and it's one of the best skits, and it's,
I know, it's insane. And I look back at that, I you know, because they said, oh, maybe a year or two ago, like a compilation, like tape of the scenes you're in. And I saw that and I was like, my God, Jerry was a baby. And we were all babies. We looked like kids. And at the time, I remember, I think I was like 29. I was like, oh my God, I'm going to turn 30. What if people find out? This is terrible.
So, you know, then you do Seinfeld. I mean, like, your whole filmography is just one amazing piece of the work after another. Like, I mean, that'd have to be a great experience for, I mean, and you're so great as Tina. Like, give me a break. Like,
oh my God, I love that. Well, basically, I was just doing, like, because I'm from upstate and outside of Syracuse, there's so many characters up there because half my town was half rural, like farm community, and half of them were sophisticated and went to work in the city, which my friends thought was so funny. Like, do you mean New York? I'm like, no, Syracuse. But anyway, so there were so many characters, and that character was just completely someone that I knew from high school. Like, it was a complete imitation. And actually, while I'm talking about that, I've written a movie, and it's going to be shot in outside of Syracuse, in my town, Cazenovia.
Wow.
In the fall.
Wow. And that's been written, casted, ready to go?
I wrote it, and it's finished, and I have it's going to be an independent. And, you know, Syracuse has this huge new film hub up there, like a $15 million film hub. And they have tax breaks. And I actually did a movie up there this past summer called The Shed. And you know, I've gotten to know a lot of the film people up there. So, yeah, we're going to shoot it up there in the fall.
How fantastic is that?
I know, is that great?
That's awesome. And so, does that happen a lot? Do you, when as an actor, do you find a lot that you work off of personal experience, like where Tina was somebody you knew? Does that happen a lot?
Definitely.
Yeah.
I think, you know, my character in Men in Black, honestly, was this this commercial in Syracuse, and there was this girl that used to do this. This commercial, and it was a complete imitation. But, you know, because some people are like, oh, you know, that was really interesting. Like, I did a one-woman show once, and these people were like, oh, and I did all these different characters, and they're like, oh, I really got the theme. I was like, there was no theme. I just did characters that I thought were funny, and then a lot of them were based on people that I knew.
Well, I mean, and I hate going through people's filmography because I feel like it's like, I really? I didn't know that was in my filmography. Like, but I have to just cover a few of these because they're so amazing. Like, I had the Dan Loria, who is the dad in The Wonder Years, on a couple episodes ago.
Oh, yeah, I love him.
But you remind me a lot of him in this regard. Your role as Dorothy Harris in Forrest Gump. Like, you didn't have to say much. The way you guys express yourself as actors, like, I just, it's something I don't think you can teach. I don't know what they call it. I don't know what the acting term for it is. But without even talking, your acting is so effective.
I really appreciate that. Well, that's a story, too, with Forrest Gump. Because my very first movie ever was the movie Greedy. And that Phil Hartman was my husband, actually. And Michael J. Fox was the lead. And Kirk Douglas was the lead. Was the father. It's insane. And he actually from Amsterdam, New York, originally, and went to St. Lawrence, which is all near me. So he and I really hit it off. Anyway, so when I went in for Forrest Gump, I was actually supposed to be – wait, let me think about this. Yeah, I was supposed to be this tiny other part. And I was like, to Bob Zemeckis, I become very good friends with Mary Ellen Zemeckis. She became one of my best friends. She passed away a couple of years ago. She was the greatest girl. She went by Mary Ellen Trainer for acting. She was in a lot of movies. Anyway, she and I became great, great friends. And she's like, my husband is going to be directing this movie, Forrest Gump. And you should go in. There's a small part. So I go in. And I was like, wait. I read it. And I'm like, it's part of a bus driver. I was like, I took the bus every day of my life with this woman, Betsy Benfelt, who was great. She was a total character. And I was like, I go in and I said, listen, I don't want to audition for that part. I want to audition for the bus driver. And he's like, you do? And I was like, yeah, I do. Anyway, so that's what happened.
Oh, my God. So, you know, and the whole movie, right, is based on judgment, how people see Forrest, how people, you know, he's worried about judgment. But here's this, right, like, breath of fresh air bus driver that, like, it's a smaller role, but it's a huge kind of moment both times in the movie. And that's, I don't know, to me, those roles are, like, what make a movie, right? They're the foundation.
Well, that's what I love doing. I remember in college, what the heck was the name of the – oh, The Real Inspector Hound was the name of the play. And it was – you know, I went to a little Jesuit college, and so I was getting a lot of the leads. And at the time, I wasn't as weird looking as I am now.
Oh, stop.
Or they didn't have any people. So I kept getting the roles of the ingenue. And so this was this play called The Real Inspector Hound, and I think it was like the end of my sophomore year. Anyway, so – they're like, okay, so we want you to, you know, be the they want you to audition for the, you know, the pretty girl. Even though I wasn't that, I wasn't pretty enough to be the pretty girl, but they're just working that. There was this big pool. But anyway, I was normal enough looking that I could have gone for that. Anyway, so I said, no, I don't want to be that part. I want to be the weird maid. I want to be the weird maid, and I want to audition for that, Mrs. Drudge. So that's what happened. So I did, and then I was like, I love doing, I'd rather do a small character part than a straight role any day.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, I mean, did you, like, in my last question about Forrest Gump, did you find that when that comes to fruition, the whole movie's made, I mean, it was such a big part of the movie because the whole audience is waiting for that child to, like, just, it, you know, it's just, it's such a key moment. I mean, do you see it the same way I see it, or do I see it more like a fan sees it?
Well, here's the thing. Because I'm an Irish Catholic, I don't really like to give myself that much credit, but I appreciate you thinking that.
Yeah, because it is true too. You know, I know you've had roles where, I read this somewhere. It was they wanted you to do something so ridiculous, and you're like, nah, I'm okay. And then you let your convictions lead the way. You know,
I know it's killed my bank account. That just recently happened to me again, and I was like, oh shoot. You know, it's really a bummer when you get a script and you're like, oh God, this is really going to set me up for a year or two. And then you read it and you get to about page four and you're like, shoot, I cannot do this. I can't do it. I can't stand it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But oh well.
Siobhan, do directors or writers, or do they work with you a lot? Not just you, but actors in general. Do you find that happens a lot, or is it kind of like, nope, this is my way, this is how it works, this is it?
It depends. It depends on the director. You right. know what I mean? It depends on if they're like, it totally depends. I mean, there's so many really great guys and women that I've worked with that are like, really will listen to you. But that's why I do feel sorry for people starting off now, because, you know, it's a rougher deal, because kind of more anything goes.
Yeah. I mean, and Funny Games was kind of an intense movie. That was pretty intense.
Oh my God, I know. I've never seen it.
Yeah. But I have to say, you know, you mentioned Fever Pitch, great movie. Holes is a phenomenal movie. I mean, people love that movie. I mean, that's, I mean, even the roles
that movie I love, and I love Andy Davis, the director of that movie, is truly like the classiest, greatest guy ever.
I mean, kids love that movie. So you mentioned his name, right? So is that a director that, you know, that works with actors, will say, you know what?
Completely. He's such an actor's director. He's just the greatest guy. He's
yeah.
Pure class.
But even, like, movies that people don't, like, that aren't brought up in a lot of your interviews, like Boiler Room, like, you're in so many, like, great, like, just great movies, and I don't know, like, I feel like Negotiator, like, it all works, like, you're not like these, like, no-name productions, which there's nothing wrong with. I'm not, you know, trying to, you know,
right.
But it's like your filmography is just, and I told you this before, it's amazing. I mean, it's just the way things worked out. It's just, and it's a compliment to your abilities.
Well, I really appreciate that. And, you know, just like any other actor, though, there's times when you're like, oh my gosh, you know, the clock goes differently for an actor than it does for someone looking in. Like, I'll say to my sisters, like three sisters, I'm like, oh my God, I need a job. I haven't worked in forever. And they're like, what are you talking about? You should have a movie in August. I mean, this is the next time I worked was December. I go, it's December. And, you know, as the kids get older, you know, when I was so busy with the kids, you'd be like, oh my gosh, like, I have a job, and I'm like, this job better end, because these kids aren't going to know who I am, or, you know, my house is like an insane asylum. But now, as you get older, the kids aren't, you know, my youngest is a senior, I'm like, I need a job.
You know, but I feel like your foundations as an actor are there, right? I feel like people that are naturally funny like you can absolutely do drama, but I really feel like it is not a two-way street. I feel like somebody's very dramatic that isn't so funny. I find that you can tell. It's, and we kind of touched on this earlier, but I feel like you can tell. Am I off with that?
Well, you're, yeah. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I know, like, with me, I was pegged for comedy for sure, for years. And then Lars von Trier, who does all, you know, Dancer in the Dark and this, you know, the Danish director, and I just did his The House that Jack Built, and I've done three movies with him.
Yeah.
He didn't know that I was pegged for comedy. And one of my kids was up all night long with the, you know, with a terrible croup cough. My family's like plagued with whenever they got sick, they'd have really bad coughs. So I was literally up all night long, and I had the audition for Dancer in the Dark next day, and people are like, oh my gosh, you have an audition for Lars von Trier? He's one of the most fabulous directors in the world. Meanwhile, I was like, I don't know who he is, even though, because I didn't have time to even look up, because I just kept having children. Anyway, so I go down, and I was so exhausted, and I was like, I had to cry, and I was like, I'm just going to cry. And it has nothing to do with this role, because I'm just so tired, and I am so tired, I'm just going to cry now, because I haven't had any sleep. So, anyway, then I end up getting the part, which broke that, you know, that was a very serious part. The whole thing of being pegged as a comedic, just comedic. So that was really lucky.
Yeah, and people don't even consider that, how difficult that must be to, you know, to be an actor, to have a family, to kind of, you know, you're torn 3, 4, 5 different ways. I mean, that's very difficult, I would believe.
Oh my gosh, I brought my kids to every, like, I brought them to Australia to Charlotte's Web. I took them to Sweden. I would take them, and, you know, I'd, like, negotiate, okay, we all have to have business class. I'd have, like, a newborn baby, a 3-year-old, a 5-year-old. People would be looking at me like, you've got to be kidding me. And then, you know, the cast would all be going out at night, and I'd be like, yeah, I gotta go home. I'm gonna be with, you know, slinging bottles. But, yeah, I made sure that I made my kids part of it, and believe me, I remind them of it every day.
because of your convictions, a lot of your filmography is, you know, kid friendly, and, you know, movies like, you know, Daddy Daycare, you know, we talked about Holes a little bit. I mean, do your kids remember being on the set of some of these movies? They were young, I know that, but
they do. When we filmed Charlotte's Web, it was in Australia. My son was in kindergarten, my daughter was in third grade, and they were extras, and they were like hoodlums. I remember poor Gary Winnick, who's now gone, he was a great guy, and he was like, Siobhan, you've got to control your kids, because all they wanted was the cat and cotton candy. They didn't realize it was a prop, and they were like, why can't we eat this? But, you know, and then my son, when I was in Baby Mama, he played my son. They cut him, though, and the night of the premiere, he dropped to his knees. He's like, what? I was cut?
Oh,
but anyway,
man.
Yes, and then I just did Going in Style, you know, Michael Caine, Morgan Freeman, Alan Arkin, we're in it, and my son came, and he worked for a day. And of course, I made him my dancing partner. I was like, "Yeah, I'll have that boy right there."
You know, I'm so embarrassed. I even, like, Baby Mom, another great movie. Like, I try not to read people's filmography, because I feel like it's like, thanks, I know what I've been in. But, like, it's so, like, your filmography, you're bringing up ones I totally forgot. But, like, yeah, I mean, these, and I forget actors, especially what you're saying now. Many of these movies, you know, are kind of place markers for things that have been going on in your own personal lives, right?
Oh, completely.
Yeah, and that's something that probably escapes a lot of people when they go see movies, and, you know, and you're still a working actor, which is unbelievable. You're shooting your own movies. I mean, my gosh, at what point does it, like, and you still love it more than ever, it seems.
Oh my gosh, yes. I remember when Lauren Bacall was in Dogville with me, and we were going up this ramp, and she was 80, and she's like, Siobhan, it was getting to be sort of the end of the shoot. She's like, do you have any jobs lined up? And I was like, no, not yet. Do you? And she's like, no. She said, do you believe this? I'm 80 years old, still looking for a job. I was like, I totally get it. That's the way it is. It never ends.
And your sense of humor would jive 100% with Amy Poehler and Tina Fey. I mean, I see absolutely why. You know,
yeah, they're hysterical.
Do you find, you're obviously accomplished, we've gotten that down, but, like, do you find you're always learning? Do you find, like, when you're on a set, you're like, wow, I like the way so-and-so does that, or the way this writer kind of, you know, put this together, the way that director wants me to, do you learn a lot, or is it?
I think so, definitely, and also, you know, you have a great appreciation for, like, a great costume designer, or, you know, like, if there's a dialect coach, there's all kinds of different elements that go into, you know, production that you can learn something from someone along the way. You know what I mean?
Right. Right. And, you know, because, I mean, I always feel like there's some actors in the world that, like, get to a certain place and they're like, I'm good. You know, I'll do 3 takes and that's it. You use the best one. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like there's a lot of those people, too.
Right. But so much of it's technical, too. It's like, well, you might think you could use that last take, but the lighting wasn't good out in an airplane flew over. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm glad you like the take, but no one can hear it.
is there, and I hate asking this question, but with you, I feel like it's important. Is there a role or two or more than that, that you look at more fondly than others? Is there one that like kind of sits with you? And I'm sure you get that all the time.
Well, you know, it's funny. Like I love doing New in Town with Harry Connick Jr. and Renee Zellweger, cause I really love them. They're great people. And yep. We had a great time. And then all the movies I did with Lars von Trier, I love because I love him and I love the way the Europeans, I love the way the Danish do it. And the people are such good people. And it's a completely different system over there. And I just, you know, it's kind of an all for one and one for all deal. And I'm very close with all of them. And then there's ones where I love because of where I got to take my kids, like Charlotte's Web, you know, the kids got to go, you know, to Australia. So, and I love doing Charlotte's Web too, but they all have sort of different reasons. You know what I mean?
Right. Right. No, I absolutely understand that. And do you find, because you're a very honest person, like you're not a BSer, you shoot from the hip. Do you find that people have a problem with that? Do you find it like in your profession, people have a problem with somebody who speaks their mind?
I think they do, especially more when you're younger. But now that I'm my age, it's like, it's more acceptable. Right. You know, it's kind of like when you run around the block, they're like, okay, this is just the way it goes. You know, you can say what you want as you get older more.
Yeah.
Which is, my kids are like, oh my gosh, Mom, do you imagine what you're going to be like when you're 80? It's going to be horrible.
So, Siobhan, I have a few more questions, if you don't mind. You've been so awesome to me this whole time. Who makes you laugh? Like, who are people or actors that, outside of your family, like, who are actors that make you laugh? Who do you enjoy? I read something where you like Zach Galifianakis, I think.
Yeah, he's hilarious. I also love Will Ferrell. He's so funny. I love The Office. We watch The Office over and over again. I love it. Like, Steve Carell. I love Diane Weiss. She's hysterical. Who else? Oh, Bill Murray, I think is, my daughter just yelled from downstairs, Bill Murray. I love Bill Murray. I think he's hilarious. I love Melissa McCarthy. My good friend, Monica Haran, who was on, Everybody Loves Raymond. I think she's hysterical. There's some people that are just, you know, that group, my daughter just said, Jack Nicholson, you know. those are just to name a few.
I used to love watching you and Melanie Hutzel. I used to love.
She's great.
Oh,
she's
my God.
Great girl. I saw her at the 40th too. She's a great girl. She was very funny.
Is that overwhelming? I mean, I can't even imagine what that was like. That 40th. I mean, everyone was there, right? Deservingly so. Everyone is there. It's just like.
For me, I brought my son to that, and my whole goal, I was like a lunatic. I was like, all right, Peter, we're going to introduce you to every single person you want to be introduced to. So, you know, I was like, Rihanna, come here. Hi, I'm Siobhan. Okay, this is my son, Peter, and he needs to take a picture with you. And she's like, oh, my God, are you Men in Black? And I'm like, you're Rihanna. So it was so fun. And, you know, people are just people. That's the thing. It's like, you know, in a way, who really cares?
Were you ever at the point where, you know, you're like, oh my God, I'm in a scene with Tommy Lee Jones, or oh my God, I'm in a scene with Jerry Seinfeld? Does it ever, I mean, obviously now that you've been in more movies that you're accustomed to it, but when you were younger, were you ever starstruck? Were you ever like,
I really never was. Once I did a movie with Anthony Hopkins, I was like, which by the way, I was cut from. And I was like, I have to tell you, I'm never starstruck, but I'm starstruck right now. And of course, Lauren Bacall, who she and I became friends, I was like, you know, that kind of thing to me, but pretty much I really don't care.
Right. Right.
Or I'm not starstruck.
Yeah.
I could be impressed and I think you're a fabulous actor or actress, but I'm not like, oh my gosh, I'm speechless. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And I think you have to, I think actors who might be starstruck wouldn't last very long if they were. You're right. I mean, it's something you have to get over pretty quickly.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Is there anything, I mean, your kids are so lucky to have such an awesome mom and dad.
That's
you know?
So nice.
I swear, your house seems like one of those houses where everything is so, it would be like a perfect, like, reality show. I would love to see
it. Yeah, like an insane asylum. You're like, my kids are like, yeah, it's not so great.
you mentioned the movie you're shooting, you said in the fall? Is it next fall you're going to start shooting?
Yeah, in the fall. Yes, yes.
Is there anything else you wanted to get out there that you've been working on or projects that are in development?
That is it for now. And because that's been my main focus, then hopefully, you know, something else will come along.
Well, I want to say best of luck to your oldest that's working at the Post and your son in West Virginia and your college hunting. I hope that you have safe travels. And, you know, I really could not have asked for a better guest to come on. And you were so nice.
I appreciate it. I really enjoyed talking to you.
And you never forgot. You stuck with me, and I can't thank you enough for that.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I appreciate you taking the interest.
Siobhan, thank you so much. I appreciate your time.